Right. There are no apologies at present. Notice has been received for any member as delegated authority to nominate the committee to vote under temporary standing order 1156. I don't think anybody has. Are we aware of any? No apologies. Remind members here obliged to declare any relevant financial or other interest at each committee meeting as applicable.
My bill.
Jim, your bill.
Stanley.
Any others? No. Move on to item number two, draft minutes of proceedings. Four members of the draft minutes are at page 5. Are we content that the draft minutes are an accurate recording of proceedings? Gemma?
Can I just bring up on page 9 of the pack under the SL1, it says the official joined the meeting at 15:22 and then the official left the meeting at 15:24. Obviously, that's a typo. Ian Snowden was here for longer than 2 minutes. So, just that's all. Perfect. That's okay.
Thank you very much indeed for your diligence. I think you should be commended for your diligence. Well done. Must have been I hadn't picked up on that one. That's one. Okay. But thank you very much indeed. So, with the exception of the amendments of the timing, if we're content to make those amends to those timings, are we content, therefore, these an accurate record of the proceedings? Agreed. And we're happy for these to be published on the website. Agreed. There are no matters arising at present. We move on to the first part of our main business today, oral evidence of the main estimates and budget number 3 bill. Are we bringing Jonathan in via Thai conferencing?
Yep, it should be.
Should be. Hi, everybody. Hi, Jeff. Hi, Barry. And we're just saying, Jonathan, could you hear us?
Yes, I can hear
you. Wave your hand.
So you can also hear me?
Yeah, we can indeed. You look scarily like Sam McBride, which will probably scare an awful lot of people around here.
Oh,
but indeed, but welcome and the rest of it. The following papers are relevant to this agenda item. The clerk's brief of the main estimates on page 16, the departmental briefing on the main estimates on page 20, and the Department of Finance briefing paper, Use of Sole Authority of the Budget Act, on page 446. Jeff, who's going to lead off?
All right, I'll start if that's okay.
Yeah.
So, good afternoon. The main estimates and associated budget bill are a regular stage in the public expenditure and legislative process, whereby the executive seeks the Assembly's approval in legislation for the spending plans for the financial year. What is less usual this year is that these are being brought to the Assembly much later in the year than would normally be the case. As the committee will recall, the urgency of the response required to the COVID-19 pandemic meant that the main estimates and budget number two, or sorry, had the main estimates and budget number two bill been prepared to reflect the executive's opening 2020-21 budget position, it would not have provided authority for departments to access sufficient cash to deliver services in response to the pandemic, due to the unprecedented level of additional allocations being made by the executive in response to the COVID emergency. The consequences of departments running out of cash under those circumstances would have been unthinkable.
Jeff, just a quick one. Could you just, and maybe you're coming to it in your brief, could you just say with one thing we're not aware of, obviously, is the additional Barnett consequentials that were mentioned this week. And I think either the First Minister or the Finance Minister has alluded to the fact it's about an extra 200 million. If that's the case, what is the overall total we've actually had on top of what within the estimates are?
The additional amount is 2.4 billion over and above what we would have.
And that includes
expected.
The 200 additional. Okay. Thanks.
To compound this, the executive's expenditure plans continued to rapidly evolve since the start of April, and any attempt to produce an estimates document based on the up-to-date expenditure plans would have meant that it would have been obsolete before it could have been completed. In response to this situation, the Finance Minister asked the Assembly to pass a budget bill seeking the Assembly's approval for a further vote on account to ensure that departments would have access to the cash needed to continue to deliver services until the autumn. And the Assembly passed this as the Budget No. 2 Act Northern Ireland 2020 in June. Following the Executive's agreement of a series of allocations in response to the COVID-19 pandemic and to support the economic recovery, which the Finance Minister announced on the 24th of September, there is now an opportunity for the 2020-21 main estimates to be considered based on the Executive's up-to-date expenditure plans. This Budget No. 3 bill gives formal authority for the expenditure plans set out in the main estimates for the 2020-21 financial year, which were laid in the Assembly yesterday. A background paper was provided to committee last week, which sets out the overall context, including a summary of the allocations which the Finance Minister has announced. Whereas the main estimates and corresponding budget bill would normally be introduced at the start of financial year and so would be written to the Executive's opening budget position, these main estimates and budget bill have been written to reflect the Executive's up-to-date expenditure plans, including just over $2.3 billion of allocations which have been or are anticipated to be made in response to COVID-19 and for the economic recovery. As explained in the briefing paper, the main estimates and budget number 3 bill contain two elements of headroom, which I'll just explain. These are $600 million resource headroom for the Department of Health. The reason for this is that the Executive has agreed to hold this sum centrally from the monies confirmed by the UK Government, pending an assessment by the Department of Health as to the amount that it will require for the remainder of the financial year. As Health could bid for the full amount of this, the decision was taken to include this headroom to ensure that Health will have access to sufficient cash to spend this allocation if and when the Executive agree to make it. And the second element of headroom is for £30 million for the Executive Office in anticipation that the Northern Ireland Investment Fund will require a further allocation of £30 million of financial transactions capital. As the Executive is currently holding an amount of £100 million FTC, it is reasonable to assume that the Executive would agree to allocate that full £30 million if and when it is bid for.
It hasn't been bid for?
I understand that it will be part of October monitoring.
And is that possibly for McGee, or is it? Or
no, that's for the Northern Ireland Investment Fund. So that's for the fund that looks at. It's the private sector fund that looks at, primarily, I think, at things like Grade A office accommodation, areas like that.
Yeah, not 30s. We're looking on the October monitoring round.
Yes, it's anticipated to be part of October monitoring. Yeah.
Maybe is Sam McBride trying to get in?
As well as seeking approval for the expenditure for the remainder of the 2020-21 financial year, the bill, together with the associated statement of excesses, seeks approval to regularise the excess expenditure which occurred in 2016-17 year. Following the collapse of the Executive at the start of 2017, no spring supplementary estimates or associated budget bill could be progressed by the Assembly that year. And as a result, a number of departments which had received in-year allocations through the monitoring round process during 2016-17 financial year exceeded the cash and resource limits set by the Budget Act Northern Ireland 2016 and the Budget No. 2 Act Northern Ireland 2016. These resulted in excesses being incurred by the departments and the other bodies concerned. In the normal course of events, once these excesses had been examined and reported on by the Controller and Auditor General, they would have been considered by the Assembly's Public Accounts Committee during the year after they were incurred, and provided the Public Accounts Committee was in agreement, they would have been included in a statement of excesses alongside a budget bill in 2018. However, as the Assembly did not sit again until 2020, the Assembly's Public Accounts Committee had not been able to consider the CNAG's report on these excesses until July of this year. This, therefore, is the first opportunity for these excesses to be regularised through the Statement of Excesses and their inclusion in this Budget No. 3 bill. While the majority of these excesses would not have occurred had the spring supplementary estimates been passed at the start of 2017, I just would highlight that there was an amount of $2.22 million for the Health and Social Care Pensions Scheme that would still have occurred as a result of the current service costs used in the budgetary process being underestimated as a result of actual payroll details not being available at the time. So therefore, it would have still been an excess. The details of each of the excesses and the Public Accounts Committee's recommendations are contained in the Public Accounts Committee's report on the matter. As you know, as with any budget bill, a critical issue
just
is the.
Sorry, have we had a? Did this actually the excess actually go to the PAC since it's been reconstituted?
It did. Yes, yes, it did.
The committee considered their report. I think it was the 9th of September.
Right. Okay.
First meeting.
I think a copy. We had forwarded a copy of the report. Sorry, with the briefing. As you know, as with any budget bill, a critical issue is the need to seek the committee's agreement to accelerated passage under Standing Order 42.2. in respect of the Budget Number 3 Bill. Of course, this can only be given on the basis that there has been appropriate consultation, and our main purpose here today, therefore, is to assist the committee with its scrutiny of the main estimates, the Statement of Excesses and the associated Budget Number 3 Bill. Chair, these are the key issues that I'd like to highlight now, and we're happy to take any further questions.
Okay. Thank you very much indeed. Jim. We're being remarkably quiet and sort of acquiescent today and all this.
I think our minds have been on other things this morning for some strange reason.
Chair, I have a couple of questions.
Yes, just please.
Could I take you to the, because I've more or less lost track of this, the RHI overspend at page 42 of the estimates. It shows that £33.4 million is appearing in the IMI spend. Yes?
It's page 42
of the estimates.
Yes.
You see.
Yes, sorry. 33.470. Yes.
Yeah. Is that? Does that indicate that Treasury is still funding the AMI on that, or is it an adjustment to Ardell to compensate for overspend?
My understanding is that that is within the AMI envelope allowed for RHI, and that the current profile on RHI, because of the cost caps, has driven it below the EME profile, and therefore there is no additional DEL spend at this stage.
There's no additional DEL spend. So is that the ongoing total spend in this year on RHI?
Yes.
And that doesn't involve any overspend?
It doesn't involve any breach of that EME cap.
Right. Okay, could I return to the ubiquitous black boxes issue? There still appears a number of those of quite substantial proportions. There is the £34 million in welfare, there's £8 million in good relations, and still there is £14 million in NI screen. Did we not pass legislation
yes.
on NI screen?
If I can just explain about Northern Ireland screen, the £14.6 million that you see there is the amount that earlier in the year the Department for Economy asked the Department of Finance to agree to be included on sole authority of the Budget Act this year. That's the full expenditure on Northern Ireland screen for the year. Since they asked for that approval, you're correct that legislation has now gone past. Now, the legislation was passed at the start of the year, but there was some additional approvals required before it came into force. It has now come into force, so we are now anticipating the Department for Economy to revise the amount that they are seeking approval on the sole authority of the Budget Act down. But as we didn't have that at the time that the main estimates were being produced, so I'm anticipating that when spring supplementary estimates are brought to the Assembly at the end of the financial year, that figure will be significantly lower than what it is at the moment.
But that couldn't be done for these estimates?
It wasn't able to get it done for these estimates.
In regard to black box expenditure, which is expenditure under the authority of the Budget Act,
yes,
that hasn't any other authority. The public money, managing public money, is pretty clear that supply division has to give approval to all of that. Are all those approvals in place?
They are, which is why, for example, because the approval that is in place at the moment for Northern Ireland screen was for the £14 million amount. That approval now needs to be revised. But it hadn't been at the time that the estimates were.
Can the committee see the letters of approval?
We can provide those for you, yes.
I'd be grateful if you would. And do those letters of approval, as you'd expect, because this shouldn't go on indefinitely, do those letters of approval require and comment on any timetable for regularising this, the expend?
Some will. Well, there would certainly be comment. Some of those areas, there will be a stipulation that DOF will expect legislation to have been put in place.
Isn't there a 2-year period when you're meant to
It would normally be less than a 1.5 million threshold or a 2-year period.
Yeah.
So there are some as well where legislation, for example, the welfare reform mitigations, we had actually expected that legislation would now have been in place for that. However, that is still being considered at the executive, so I'm not able to be able to confirm.
So many of those black box expenditures are in excess of the 2-year period?
I know HMS Carolines is in excess of the 2-year period. This is one that we have been discussing with DfE recently. HMS Caroline closed to the public in March at the start of the pandemic. At the same time, there has been negotiations between DfE and the National Museum of the Royal Navy as to the long-term arrangements, because we were expecting the use of sole authority of the Budget Act to cease this year for HMS Caroline.
Is there a line in the economy estimates for 420,000?
There is, yes, or 450,000.
450,000.
We had expected that use of sole authority, for example, for HMS Caroline to cease this year because a new contract arrangement was due to being put in place with the National Museum of the Royal Navy, which would have meant that sole authority of the Budget Act would no longer have been required because there would have been a contractual arrangement in place. That hasn't happened, and we understand that Department for Economy and National Museum of the Royal Navy are currently in negotiations over what the future relationship would be. The 450,000 that you see there is what Department for Economy had asked for approval for us to agree to ensure that the ship is maintained as an attraction in the interim while those future contractual arrangements are in place.
So, and is that out to the end of the financial year or to the end of the year? Because I understand the contract negotiations are supposed to be finished, or I think the Minister has stated that at the 31st of December is the cut-off date.
You may be right. Now, apologies, I don't have the exact date, sir, but I know certainly that 450,000 is what.
Sorry, I should have declared an interest as an HMS Caroline rating from many, many moons ago. As soon as you said the word HMS Caroline, my ears pricked up. Yeah. Not that they're always attentive.
I could actually join you in that. So,
old boys club.
Yeah,
sorry. that is what the Department of Economy have told us for the remainder of this year, to ensure the maintenance of the ship pending the confirmation of what the future relationship will be with the National Museum of the Royal Navy. Northern Ireland Screen, as you've already mentioned, that has been running for more than 2 years because we have been awaiting this legislation, because the Assembly hadn't been sitting. As you know, that legislation hadn't been able to be progressed, but it has now been put in place, so that will end this year. Now, the expenditure up to the point at which the legislation came into force this year will remain on sole authority of the Budget Act, but that...
Could I just ask you about the almost 8 million of black box on good relations, page 219 of the estimate?
Likewise, the social investment fund has been, this relates to the social investment fund, and this likewise has been running for more than 2 years. It was when it was first began, it was initially, the expenditure was initially on the sole authority of the Budget Act pending legislation being brought forward. However, again, when the Assembly stopped sitting, it was no longer possible to bring any legislation forward. Now that the Assembly has been restored, the Executive Office, the information from the Executive Office is that the expenditure is due to be wound up. And initially, it was thought that it would cease in this current calendar year, the 2020 calendar year. My understanding is that there has been some delay, so it will extend into the 2021 calendar year, but not beyond that. So therefore, by the time any new legislation could actually be progressed through the Assembly, it would be obsolete.
Mm-hmm.
So we would anticipate that the expenditure on this until the such an investment fund ceases, that it will remain on sole authority for the Budget Act.
You just give them a bye-ball, isn't it?
Well, if it's not physically possible for the Executive Office to bring legislation through the Assembly before the fund ceases, and given that the Executive had committed to the Social Investment Fund, we were sort of left with that decision to make, and it had been approved. It made use of sole authority of the Budget Act during the time that Budget Acts were being passed through Westminster, and this is just the tail of the programme.
So each of these approval letters that you're going to let us see will set out the rationale for approval in each case?
Well, they will certainly confirm the amounts and the terms. Whether the rationale is actually set out in the approval letter or in the supporting correspondence, without having each letter in front of me, I can't say that it'll all be in the approval letter itself, but it will be in the supporting correspondence that there's been between the departments and the UEF.
Okay. Thank you for now. Thank
you, Jim. Paul.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks very much for your presentation. Of course, the Minister made a statement last week about flexibilities, requesting flexibilities from Treasury, one of them being on the transfer of money from capital resource. What work has been done within the department if that wish was ever to become true?
You're correct that the Minister is speaking with Treasury on that particular issue, as are all devolved administrations, seeking to find additional flexibility in order for us to manage the budget within the resources that we have, rather than asking for additional resources in one category or another. We have been monitoring the overall budget position and continue to do so. We do that on a monthly basis with returns from departments to ensure that our overall spend is within our control total limits. The flexibility that we would be requesting potentially could extend into future years, and at that stage a more strategic decision could be taken on what the overall capital and resource envelopes look like. We would only have the fuller picture once we have the spending review outcome, and allows us to see what our normal resource and capital envelope would be, to understand then the degree to which we can flex within that. But it gives us an opportunity to respond quite dynamically to changes that might be last minute. If I can give you an example of in March, where we had we did not have that flexibility. There was an overspend on our an underspend on our capital, which we could have managed a little bit more dynamically had we been the ability to do a little bit of flex there.
What's the status of the CSR at the moment?
The Chancellor has, as you know, he has cancelled the UK autumn budget. Mm-hmm. The word that we have from Treasury officials is that they are still aiming to have a multi-year spending review, which will be published in the autumn. And we have no, despite repeated pressing on what autumn means, we have no further clarity on that.
The 21st of December.
Absolutely, yes.
So can I ask them, if I'm reading what you're saying right, it's not so much, whilst the Minister asked for a whole suite of tools with regards to flexibility in a statement, the one around transferring money from capital to resource, what you're saying to me is then it would really only be a spring action or a late winter action when you realised that there would not be a fulfilling of capital spend, rather than moving money from capital to resource in the general sense?
So it would, for future years, it would be helpful, and we could do planning on that process. For the current year, if we had flexibility on resource and capital, it would allow us to respond very quickly to emerging pressures. So if there was a continuation of the second wave of COVID or into a third wave of COVID, and pressure was apparent in the health system, for instance, on staffing costs. And we knew that because of the third wave and associated lockdowns that capital projects were being delayed. We could at that stage then transfer funding from capital to resource to manage those pressures. But it is, at this stage, it would be a reactive understanding the wider picture.
Is that a good example? Because it seems to me, and it might be the case, that the health minister has given money back on resource because he can't... You can't increase staff costs if you don't have additional staff, if you know what I mean. So, and then, of course, that's a slow burn, cog-turning slowly machine in that regard with training staff. But does that... Does the department have engaged the reaction to that statement from last week on people throughout departments and in the private sector with regards to their reaction and how they'll plan for the year ahead if they think that they won't have the capital spend that they would have expected?
I mean, I think, yes, it's probably not the greatest example on health, and apologies for that, but it is an ability for us to flex whenever we see the system moving in front of us in terms of resource pressures and capital pressures. On your second point, it's not easy to tell. It's difficult to tell at this stage, but certainly departments, we are engaging with departments, as I say, on a monthly basis and informally on a much more frequent basis to understand what their capital and their resource costs look like. They provide returns, which we then forward on to the committee here in terms of forecast outturn to say what they're indicating they're going to spend up to the end of the financial year. And once we... this is... The Minister wants this as an option rather than a we will do something with this if we get it. But it certainly is something that we would like to have effectively up our sleeves if things changed or the dynamic changed within the public expenditure system.
But surely if you're asking for that flexibility, you must have uses for it. So let's say, for instance, would the Finance Minister decide to populate a business grant scheme with capital spend?
The potential is, I mean, I guess we're talking a little bit in hypotheticals, but the potential is you get to February and there's a further lockdown. Capital spend has been pulled back because people can't get onto building sites, projects don't go forward, and there is real need within the business sector. At that stage, then absolutely that capital to resource flexibility would be, we could kick that in at that stage, provide the grants to businesses, and then, you know, without kind of detriment to what has already happened in terms of the reduced capital assessment.
But again, there should be no reason why building sites, true sense, couldn't continue through a lockdown.
Yes, absolutely. I mean, it's just an example, and it depends on, I suppose, what ultimately is happening on the capital side of things towards the end of the year. We're keeping that under control or under monitoring.
With regards to your budget process for this year, for the budget next year, what processes are ongoing and have been completed to date?
So we are looking at departmental returns. So departments themselves have provided information to our department on what their bids for the next 3 years look like, and we are looking at those and starting to do an assessment of those. We'll not be able to do much more in terms of looking at the overall context until we get the outcome of the spending review, which will set the budget envelope for future years. But we are working with departments on their needs. The Minister will be meeting with his ministerial colleagues bilaterally in the coming weeks to get a better assessment from them of their needs and what the pressures look like for their departments and where things can be changed or assessed.
in the vacuum of not having an autumn budget or a statement from the Chancellor, what figure or envelope do you go by? Do you go by the year previous, give or take tolerance of 5 or 10%? How does it work?
So the way that it works on the ground is that we will create a baseline for departments, and that we'll look at previous year's spend, and then we will strip back anything that is time bound. So if a programme is due to come to an end, we'll take the funding out from that from the department, and we'll give them effectively a baseline position. Now, how that baseline then is impacted going forward will depend on what that overall number looks like. So for some departments, that baseline could increase, some departments it could reduce, some departments could stay the same. We just don't know yet what that bigger impact, and it will depend on what pressures there are in the system. So some departments may be able to survive relatively well on a baseline position, and some departments, because of new or emerging issues, will require additional funding. And it's that kind of those issues that were being teased out and will be teased out with the bilateral engagement with the Minister.
When's your next deadline?
In some ways, our next deadline is a waiting game for the spending review outcome.
Mm-hmm. And you can do no more until that?
There are things that we can do in the background in terms of liaising with departments and engaging on that process, but that will be the key driver for how we go forward.
Okay, final question, Chair. Main estimates this period we're looking at, what's in that scares you that you haven't yet told us about?
There's nothing in this document that scares me. Without beating about the bush, I think the big concern, I'm sure it would be the same for everybody, is what is going to happen with COVID. Mm-hmm. Because obviously we have written this document to the executive's up-to-date budget position based on our knowledge of the funding that has been raised locally, plus the block grant and the Barna consequentials that we received. And if something happens after this that requires a further increase in public expenditure, then that's going to create a problem. And
lockdown that was announced this morning.
It's the expenditure that goes with the lockdown. The lockdown itself doesn't actually, it's in itself cost, but it's the expenditure that will then be needed to support the economy.
Could I just unpack that a bit, because it was quite interesting, sort of the comment said, look, you're now getting monthly returns from all the sort of the departments. So in essence, then trying to wait for monitoring rounds coming in that we never seem to see until it's well past the point, you've probably got a very good handle now on where the pressures are, but also where the underspends are. So which departments at the moment have we got headroom in? Because bearing in mind, one of the things we do want to see is, as much as this 200 million that's come in from Barnett consequentials for business support goes directly to business support, but how much are there areas of headroom have we got? Because I think you must have a fairly good idea of it now, because look, the chances of us getting substantial capital spend done between now and the end of the financial year, I think, are rapidly diminishing. So we must have an idea of that envelope at the moment.
So part of that analysis will also then feed into the likes of October monitoring. So departments have been...
Which it is, it's October now. Yeah.
Yes, so departments have been engaging in that, and we're just finalising that piece of work at the minute. There will be, from departments, there will be reduced requirements, and that is an effect of looking at what they're potentially spending through the year and saying, well, obviously they're coming up short in some areas, and that then is presented back to the executive for redistribution. So we are looking at those numbers now and finalising those with the minister, and we would hope to be in a position to inform the committee of that next week.
Well, that's good, because we've got a real problem here in that any of the identified savings that we have, and bearing in mind it has to be spent in year.
Yes.
So the amount of pressure that will be on to departments to look, unless we can get some kind of arrangement with the Treasury, and one of the questions that we'll ask the committee after this is, you know, are we content to support the Minister in his attempts to allow a greater flexibility and transfer of funds from the Treasury, but we'll discuss that afterwards. But I think the key question is here is that there's going to be an awful lot of pressure to either spend the resource that we have or allocate it to the departments that are actually going to need it in the short period of time. And I think, as Paul and many members here will be alluding to, there is real issues now within the business community of that business support through that period. But what we don't want to see is something like we end up having to hand back 100 million quid come sort of April because we haven't been able to profile it enough or quick enough to do it. And we should be really getting those answers fairly soon. And we'll be quite keen to get the response from the Minister on that next week.
Yeah, we're very conscious that there's a balance to be struck here in terms of getting funding out and supporting and understanding then that there may be further periods of uncertainty going forward in the financial year where we may need additional funding. So the Minister is very aware of that position and I think part of October monitoring will be looking at how we support businesses that have been impacted and will be impacted from Friday.
Yep, okay. Pat?
Thanks very much. Suppose it's just to help me for myself. I've tried to understand that clause which you put down the Department of State and Standing Order 42.2. That the committee must ensure that the budget bill is given accelerated passage. Is that the case? That this budget bill is given accelerated passage, that it has to be, that the committee must ensure that the budget bill is given accelerated passage?
The budget bill cannot proceed by accelerated passage without the agreement of the committee, which is the point that I was trying to make. Yeah. Sorry, apologies if the wording is ambiguous.
And you're fairly comfortable that we have got all of that consultation which we require. I mean, that's part of the process today as well, and you've been very open with it. But are you comfortable that we've got it all there?
Well,
you know what we're like, Barry.
Through the chair. Behave.
I'm conscious that I myself and my colleagues have been to the committee on a number of occasions this year to explain, and I hope you feel that we have.
No doubt.
You're like old friends. Really? You're like old friends.
I'm sure we do thank the committee for it. Department for it. On the 6th of October, sir, the Minister had written to the Treasurer to allow a carryover of increased underspend from the financial year for the pandemic. Is there more specific areas that the Department have identified, taking in mind where we are with COVID for that underspend? I mean, is it coming out from what has been stated in the House this morning by the First Minister? I know you haven't got the crystal ball, but can you give me a wee bit more information on that?
So I think that refers to underspend from the last financial year, so at the end of March, because of COVID and the implications of COVID, a number of areas weren't able to spend fully. So we had a small underspend in capital that we couldn't manage within our overall budget exchange scheme limits. That underspend then, we pressed Treasury and we have asked Treasury to consider carry forward of that to allow us to fully utilise it. Treasury have indicated that they will consider that as part of their supplementary process, estimate process, which is coming up November, December time. So we'll be working with Treasury
So if Treasury are minded, if Treasury's not minded to grant any additional flexibility, other assurances can be given that the areas of underspend will be surrendered early in this financial year in order to allow for timely reallocation to minimise the risk of being lost back to Treasury. Because, I mean, there's one thing I do understand, look, we have to lose anything going back. I'm sure we've all common ground on that.
Departments are required to provide us with early indication as possible of their reduced requirements. So anything that they cannot spend, departments are required to surrender that to the centre for reallocation. We have and continue to press departments in our regular meetings with them on what they can and cannot spend, especially now because of COVID. So we're making sure as much as we can.
Just for myself again, the Department stated that there is a high degree of certainty that the Northern Ireland the Investment Fund can use up to 30 million on FTC funding. Given the difficulty in using that funding before in the past, I mean, is the Department certain of this?
The 30 million for the investment fund, yes certain.
Okay.
The investment fund, we're currently looking at the memorandum of understanding between the investment fund and the NICS, and yes, that will be transferred.
No, just when we're on this, the FTC, one of the things I've noticed, I think was something that was mentioned in the Assembly, I need to check Hanser to be correct, but it was the issue to do with funding for the University of Ulster for, I think it was the extra 30 million, was it?
So there was 80 million.
Oh, 80 million. Yeah. But it's not going to the University of Ulster, it's going to the Strategic Investment Board for then. Why? I'm a bit confused by that.
I was going to say, sorry, the reason is most departments don't actually have the statutory authority to make loans.
Yeah.
One of the organisations within government that does have that statutory power is the Strategic Investment Fund. Strategic Investment Board. So for a situation where financial transactions capital loan is going to be made out, we have made use of the Strategic Investment Board to channel the loans out. The department with responsibility still remains accountable for the for the project for which the loans are being made, but it's simply a matter of
values. And so there's an MOU between the university, the Department of the Economy, and the SI and the Strategic Investment Board.
Yes,
and that sets out quite clearly sort of financial responsibility and accountability.
Yes, and accountability particularly. Yes.
Okay, and we got a copy of that anywhere?
We can provide you with that. Yes.
No, it just seems quite unusual because it seems to be the SIB. It used to be Invest NI seemed to be the avenue for disbursement and distribution of funds, but at the moment the SIB seemed to be cropping up fairly regularly. Everything from looking for a replacement for the head of the Northern Ireland Civil Service to funding universities. Quite unusual way of doing things. Sorry, just an observation. Matthew.
Thank you, Chair.
Lisa, do you want in?
I wanted to ask more about financial transactions capital, if I may. Just so I'm absolutely clear about where we are with it, the briefing note provided to the committee talks about the executive retaining 100 million FTC, but as we've just discussed, 30 million of that is going to the Northern Ireland Investment Fund. So that means there is, notwithstanding any further allocations, 70 million of outstanding unallocated FTC that has to be spent before the end of this financial year?
Yes, that's correct.
And there is, I suppose, just for the sake of getting a clear answer, that from the Department of Finance's perspective, that FTC allocation is sort of not floating around, but it could be used for anything within the parameters of so it could be used, for example, to fund further business support schemes.
So yeah, financial transactions capital can be used for loans to or equity in the private sector.
It has to be. I realise it has to be a financial transaction rather than a grant. With respect to a little bit of probably strategic vagueness earlier on around the flexibilities that are being asked for from Treasury, and I think the Finance Minister was probably for a good reason vague about what exactly was being asked for from the Treasury. Are you specifically asking for, are there any flexibilities being asked for around FTC, converting that to either conventional capital or DEL, which would be quite unconventional to mix my...
There's no specific request around that area, simply because of the way the Treasury rules work, it would probably be unacceptable to them. But there is, I mean, one of the requests that we will be considering, or the Treasury will be considering, would be additional carry forward, which would allow us to carry forward additional funding rather than the cap that we have currently on FTC.
So carrying forward the FTC, including, yes. So that 70 million could be carried forward?
Yes.
Is there any active work going on in the department or elsewhere in the executive that you're aware of, looking at how that money could be dispersed as loans to business, further to this morning's announcements? Or, you know, as equity or whatever is?
I am aware that Department for Economy are looking at different ways to support business, and they are aware of the financial transactions capital that's available.
But obviously, as Barry said, there are only certain institutions within the Northern Ireland Civil Service that have the VIRES to make loans. Was that? Do you know if that work was going on? Like, has that work been going on through the summer, or is it something that began more recently as we realised we would have to have a further significant, like in the last couple of weeks when we've realised we're basically going to have a further significant series of financial support packages?
Certainly the Department for Economy have been considering how best to support business right from the get-go on this.
But does that mean, that they've been looking at the whole way through, but they've been doing... Have they started looking specifically at the FTC in the last few weeks, or was that being looked at in the summer?
No, they had been aware of that from the start of the summer, yeah.
Okay, thank you.
I think it would be worth actually saying that financial transactions capital has been around for quite a number of years. This isn't something unique to this current financial year. One of the reasons why an investment fund set up was actually because of the difficulty that central
governments had in using it.
Was as an avenue to get it out to business.
And just on the, and I know it's not, it'll be covered somewhere in a minute, but in terms of our RRI, our borrowing power, basically, what sort of, where are we in this financial year in terms of our borrowing headroom?
To date, we have not borrowed on RRI this financial year.
So how much could we borrow this financial year?
Up to 200 million.
So there's 200 million that we could, and that would be via the. I don't know. How does the interest rate on that worked out? Is it sort of what the DMO is getting from?
Through the National Works Loans Board.
Public Works Loans Board, yeah.
Public Works Loans Board, yeah.
But that is obviously sort of, it's connected to whatever the sovereign, to the price of sovereign debt at any given moment.
Yes, it changes daily.
Yeah. So if the DMO have an auction for UK sovereign debt that is very low, which it is at the minute, then mm-hmm. we can be assured that the price. Okay, do you know if any work is going on at the minute to look at us making use in year of our borrowing power in order to support affected businesses?
It's something that is being considered, but at this stage, we are concerned that departments will not be able to spend fully utilise their capital budgets at this moment in time. So injecting further capital might not be the best way to do that. It's something that we have in our minds. We understand that power is there, and it may be something that we are able to utilise towards the end of the year as a tool to manage our budgets. But at this stage, there's no plans for big capital injection through RRI borrowing.
I know it's because you can only use RRI on capital spending. But is there a work of joining up going on where you're, I suppose, is the direct answer, you can give me a direct answer to this. Have people considered the possibility of if you get agreement from the Treasury to do more flexibility around capital, you then open up, if you basically have a general permission, as it were, from the Treasury, general flexibility on either a capital current switch or push, carry forward, you then know that you don't have to, that your capital allocation isn't your capital allocation, that it can be current spending, that you then get out the RRI credit card, to use a fairly lurid analogy, and spend on that. Do you know what I mean? Are you thinking about that?
That is one of the thought processes. That obviously RRI borrowing will attract a resource interest charge going forward as well. So there's a repayment element to it that we have to factor in longer term as well. But certainly that particular thought hasn't escaped me.
Okay. So you're thinking about it, but you're waiting to get permission from the Treasury first to see before you commit to...
Ultimately, further flexibility will depend on Treasury's approval, and we can't really do anything until we know that. And if there is approval in that area, the extent of that approval, it may be quite limited.
Okay.
Could we be making a special case, bear in mind, come 1st of January, we're into this sort of hybrid world that we will be here? Now, I understand one of the issues with Treasury is that they want to have a commonality across the devolved administrations, but of course we are in a different situation because we will incur substantial costs of
sort of the border down the RSC and the impact that's going to have on businesses and the rest of it. So actually there is potential now to be making a case for us to give us additional flexibility to be able to support business and the rest of it, just providing we don't get into the whole state aid bit. But is there, is this stage of the conversation, has this begun, particularly with Treasury? Because if we tie it to what the other regions do, we're going to be still having this discussion at the end of the, leading up to the end of the financial year, and many things will have moved on for us.
Yeah, the costs of implementing the protocol have been discussed with Treasury, and the Minister has been very clear that should there be costs of implementing the protocol,
that
they should
be. Have we got a delta of that yet? What the likely costs that we're putting through to?
I mean, they come in sort of two broad areas. The first one is very much on what they call the phytosanitary, the checks on animals and so on and so forth. I'm not aware offhand of the amount,
but it
is.
Get, add 50 quid to it and multiply it by a factor of 100. Yeah.
Yeah. So it's understanding those. I'm not aware, but I believe it's in the minimum. Is it over £100 million?
Yeah. Just so I don't want to really put you in the space, but maybe for the Minister next week, one of the questions that we might raise with the Minister, look, this is an important figure, and it's a figure we need to be sort of discussing now, because interim time is very rapidly marching on.
Yeah, absolutely. And the Minister has sent those figures to CST. I just don't have them to hand, so absolutely the Minister will be able to.
Good, I'll be good to do that as well. Matthew, any more?
That was, I guess it was really, but my one final question is, on the flexibilities point around the capital current switch or the push, the flexibilities you're asking for, would you expect to find it before the spending review, or
certainly the Minister is meeting with the Chief Secretary of the Treasury and his devolved counterparts next week, where he will be pressing that particular issue. It may be that if, and it's a big if they agree to any further flexibilities for the devolved administrations, it might be wrapped up within the spending round announcement.
Okay. Any other comments? Just a final one just before you go, and I probably don't have the answer to that. We've been told with the internal market bill, but there's also the other thing we need to be watching out for, particularly it's important for Northern Ireland, is the finance bill. Do we know where we are with the finance bill?
No, I'm not aware.
Okay.
Sorry, can't.
Because obviously we've been told, you know, there's one set of sort of potential derogations and the rest of it coming with the internal market bill. But then we were going to get more details within the finance bill. The finance bill was going to add more detail to sort of the bits and pieces. But again, it's October and I haven't heard anything. I just wondered if you'd heard anything about the finance bill.
Sorry, I'm not cited on that. Apologies.
Maybe just when you're talking to the Treasury, you might sort of give them a gentle,
the
hello, it's us, remember? Okay. Team, thank you very much indeed. And thank you very much indeed for coming along. And as usual, it's a pleasure. And thank you. Okay, cheers. Thanks very much indeed. Team, there's two questions have come out with this. The first one was, does the committee want to support the Minister in seeking capital to resource flexibility? And should that be something that we as a committee should be sort of saying we would wish to lend our support to the Minister in trying to achieve this? And my perspective on this is that, bearing in mind what we're having to deal with in Brexit, what we're having to deal with COVID and the rest of it, and quite frankly, I don't see how we're going to spend the capital between now and the end of the financial year, and I would rather see us being able to have some flexibility that we can support small businesses or medium-sized businesses if we could. So I'd just like to say, if we would like to say, whether anybody would like to second my thing and say we would like to support the Minister on in his approach. Sir.
Just on that, Chair, I would urge caution in this, because the Minister's statement last week sent a shockwave through a lot of the private sector. So I would worry, again, I understand you would support flexibility, but until you see a decision by the Minister in using that flexibility, that's where I would fall down.
Maybe take a different approach. The Minister's coming to speak to us next week. Maybe we can ask this Minister what his views are and ask him what he's planning. Yeah. I think would we be content with that?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Right, the second question is whether we are content to take a decision on granting accelerated passage to this bill. I see looks of a degree of incredulity around the committee. In that here we are X number of months down the line and being asked to grant accelerated passage to the bill. However, if members are content to proceed with the decision about granting accelerated passage and looking, doing that as well, I think the majority of us would like to put it to that position. So therefore, if we are content to proceed with the position, I would like to put to the committee that the Committee for Finance is satisfied that there has been appropriate consultation with it on the public expenditure proposals contained in the Budget No. 3 Bill, Northern Ireland 2020, and is content to grant accelerated passage to the bill in accordance with Standing Order 42.2, if accelerated passage is agreed. Agreed.
Agreed.
I'd also like to seek agreement the committee writes to the Speaker to reflect the sentiments and expressed and highlighted that on the basis it's not prejudicial to future budget processes, because here we are in October with the main estimates. And yes, there has been COVID, but we should have been in a position to reduce sort of more detailed procedures long before this. And if we do want to get ourselves into a regularised budget process, which I think would be the intent of this committee, and indeed probably the intent of everybody in Northern Ireland, I think I would be quite like to write to the Speaker on that basis if we are content. Lisa, content?
Agreed.
Good. Agreed. Thank you. I'm now going to move into closed session.
Programme signed. This is the Northern...
There we go. Ladies and gentlemen, we're now moving on to item number 6 on the agenda, Functioning of Government Miscellaneous Provisions Bill, formal clause by clause consideration. I'd like to inform the members that the session has been recorded by Hansard. I'd like to draw the members' attention to the following papers relating to this agenda item: the Clerk's Brief, formal clause by clause on page 456, Functioning of Government Miscellaneous Provisions Bill on page 467, Functioning of Government Miscellaneous Provisions Bill Explanatory Memorandum, page 475, Functioning of Government Miscellaneous Provisions Bill Notice of Amendments, page 481, Notice of Withdrawal of Amendments for the Consideration Stage of the Functioning of Government Miscellaneous Provisions Bill, tabled at page 3, Notice of Amendments for the Consideration Stage of the Functioning of Government Miscellaneous Provisions Bill, tabled at page 5. I'd like to remind members that they're now at the formal clause by clause stage. Is an essential part of the committee's duties and is needed for the preparation of the committee report. I'd like to advise members that the committee will proceed through the clauses and I will be putting the questions formally. Remind members that during formal clause by clause consideration, deliberations or discussions on clauses are now concluded. Okay. Inform members where there are amendments, the question on the amendment will be put first, and the question on each amendment that introduces a new clause to the bill will be put at the relevant point. Okay. Please bear with me. Starting with the first one, is Clause 1, Amendment of the Civil Service Special Advisers Act, Northern Ireland 2013. Clause 1, Subsection 2. One technical amendment is proposed by the bill sponsor. I'd like to put the question, is the committee content with the amendment proposed by the bill sponsor to Subsection 1, Subpara 2? Great. Moving on to Clause 1, Subsection...
No. I'm not content.
Sorry, you just need to speak up.
I'm not content.
So these are the amendments to the clause of the clause?
No, to the amendment.
Amendments.
Okay. I think that in our case that we don't... really have to vote on the amendment when we actually are voting against the clause in itself. So it's a material whether we vote on the amendment or not.
Yep.
Is that correct?
Chair, do you want to put the question again?
Yeah, sorry, I'll put the question again. I put the question, is the committee content with the amendment proposed by the bill sponsor to subsection 1, subpara 2?
Agreed.
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 Okay. Clause 1, subsection 3. Two amendments are proposed by the bill sponsor to retain the principle that a minister should be responsible for the conduct of their special adviser. One further amendment is proposed by the bill sponsor at page 1, line 14, to reinsert a previous process for special advisor appointments which was contained in the previous code of appointments but removed from the revised code. I put the first question. Is the committee content with the amendment proposed by the bill sponsor to subsection 1, subpara 3, line 1, line 12?
Agreed.
Agreed. Agreed. Second question, is the committee content with the amendment proposed by the bill sponsored to subsection 1, subpara 3, line 1, line 13? Are we agreed?
Agreed.
Is the committee content with the amendment proposed by the bill sponsored to subsection 1, subpara 3, page 1, line 14? Are we agreed?
Agreed.
Great. If we move on to clause 1, subsection 4, as there are no proposed amendments to this subsection, it will be considered as part of clause 1 overall. Clause 1, subsection 5, as there were no proposed amendments to this subsection, it will be considered as part of clause 1 overall. Clause 1, subsection 6, advise members that the bill sponsor is proposing an amendment at page 2, line 9, to make clear that the subsection applies specifically to special advisers. The bill sponsor is proposing a technical amendment at page 2, line 12. I put the question, is the committee content with the amendments proposed by the bill sponsor to subsection 1, subpara 6? Are we agreed?
Agreed.
Therefore, we're on to clause 1. I put the question, is the committee content with clause 1 subject to the amendments proposed by the bill's sponsor?
You're opposed.
Agreed.
So, therefore, we take a formal vote at this stage and record the vote. All those in favour of clause 1?
Sorry, just clause 1 subject to the proposed amendments.
Oh, sorry, it's clause 1 subject to the proposed amendments. I'm glad you're here. Clause 1 subject to the proposed amendments. Against? There we go. Now, if we move on to clause 2, Amendment of the Civil Service Commissioners, Northern Ireland Order 1999. Advise members, the bill sponsor is proposing two amendments to Clause 2 to change the approach to achieving the objective of reducing the number of special advisers in the Executive Office to 8 to 4. The bill sponsor is proposing an amendment at page 2, line 18, to change the wording of the bill so that the First Minister and Deputy First Minister may appoint two special advisers each. This currently stands at 3 each, and the proposal in the bill as drafted was for 1 each, with 1 special adviser for each of the junior ministers. The bill sponsor is proposing an amendment at page 2, line 19, to remove the facility for junior ministers to appoint special advisers. I'd like to inform members there was a higher level of consensus in the committee on the amendment applicable to junior ministers than there was on the amendment applicable to the First and Deputy First Minister. It is therefore suggested that the committee considers the amendment to remove the facility for junior ministers to appoint special advisers before considering the amendment on the number of special advisers overall. Are members content with this proposed approach?
Agreed.
Therefore, an amendment. Put the question, is the committee content with the amendment proposed by the bill sponsor to clause 2, page 2, line 19? Agreed?
Agreed.
But the question, is the committee content with the amendment proposed by the bill sponsor to clause 2, page 2, line 18? Are we content? Agreed. Now we move on to clause 2. Is the committee content with the clause 2 subject to the amendment proposed by the bill sponsor? All those in favour, raise their hand. That's 4. All those against, raise their hands. Those abstaining, raise their hands. Okay. Excellent. Okay. We move on to clause 3, repeal of the Civil Service Commissioners Amendment Order Northern Ireland 2016. Put the question, is the committee content with clause 3 as drafted? All those in favour, raise their hands. Against? Clause 4, Special Advisers in the Executive Office. Advised member, the bill sponsor is proposing one technical amendment to Clause 4. Put the question, is the committee content with the amendment proposed by the bill sponsor to Clause 4? All those in favour, agreed? Agreed. Against? Move on to clause 4. Is the committee content with clause 4 subject to the amendment proposed by the bill sponsor? All those in favour raise their hands. Those against?
Sorry, Chair, just to be clear, can you ask members again favour because I wasn't sure?
Oh, favour. Jim?
What's that?
And no, Melissa, I wasn't trying to influence the decision.
I'm sure you're raising it to vote for it.
I wasn't. Hang on.
I believe you.
Those against? Abstaining. Okay. Okay, if we move on to clause 5, amendment of the Assembly Members' Independent Financial Review and Standards Act, Northern Ireland 2011. Advise members, the bill sponsor is proposing 3 amendments to clause 5 as follows. Page 3, line 4. To provide protection for MLAs and ministers against vexatious complaints. Line 3, or page 3, line 11, to reduce provisions in the bill in relation to the ministerial code. Page 3, line 14, to add ministers to the ambit of the Commissioner for Standards. As the question, is the committee content with the amendments proposed by the bill sponsor to clause 5? Was agreed?
Okay.
Agreed. Those against? Oh, sorry. Pardon. So on to clause 5 now. Formulate clause 5. Clause 5, put the question, is the committee content with clause 5 subject to the amendments proposed by the bill sponsors? Those agree? Agreed. And against? Okay. We move on to clause 6, record of meetings. Advise members, the bill sponsor is proposing 1 amendment to clause 6 to reduce the burden of what must be recorded. Is the committee content with the amendment proposed by the bill sponsor to clause 6? Those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Against? Move on to clause 6. Put the question, is the committee content with clause 6 subject to the amendment proposed by the bill sponsor? All those in favour say, or all those in favour raise their hands. Those against? Abstaining. Good. Clause 7, record of contacts. Put the question, is the committee content with clause 7 as drafted? All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Against? Clause 8, presence of civil servants. Advise members, the bill sponsor is proposing 1 amendment to clause 8 to adjust the wording of the clause to make it more compatible with terms used elsewhere in the bill. Is the committee content with the amendment proposed by the bill sponsor to clause 8?
Agreed.
Agreed. Against? Clause 8. But the question, is the committee content...
Chairman, is that 1 against or 3?
I think that was...
Sorry, Chair, I think
that was just the clause that you were talking about.
Yes. Yeah, that was just the amendment. Amendment. Yeah, that's the amendment. Yeah.
The amendment.
We're just doing the clause
now.
Okay. Clause. Is the committee content with clause 8 subject to the amendment proposed by the bill sponsor? Those in favour, raise their hands. Oh, Melissa. Well done.
Out of the posse.
Those against? Okay. Clause 8A. But the question is, the committee content to note clause 8A? Those in favour raise their hands. Those against?
Can I just... You're proposing that we note clause 8A?
I didn't say that. I said I'm putting this, the committee content to note clause 8A. Yeah.
So the vote is on whether we're content to note rather than...
Yes.
Yeah. Yes.
So, can I just ask for clarification?
We didn't formally consider the evidence for 8A.
I mean, voting against noting it does what?
About noted it?
Is that you've noted it?
It's just simply that it's noted, so the committee can just... If you note an amendment, or you're not taking a view either for or against, and that was simply because, as the Chair pointed out, there wasn't enough evidence, or there wasn't due evidence received, as it wasn't part of the bill.
And so whether we note it or take no action is primarily irrelevant.
But it does record in that you voted against the noting, if you so wish.
Fair enough.
Are we content, Clerk, that we've
We've taken that vote.
Yes, vote.
Sure.
We have.
Sorry, was there a formal vote to note?
All right, in that case, we'll move on. No. Is the committee content to note Clause 8A?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. We did that. Go without a whip, you Matthew. Well,
those who are not content to note 8A. Move on to Clause 9, use of official systems. Bill sponsor is proposing one amendment to Clause 9. To change the focus from the use of non-official systems per se to the failure to record the use of non-official systems within a reasonable time period, and to introduce reasonable behaviour and public interest defence. To the amendment, is the committee content with the amendment proposed by the bill sponsor to Clause 9? Agreed? Content? Okay. So, to Clause 9, is the committee content with Clause 9 subject to the amendment proposed by the bill sponsor? Those in favour, raise their hands. Those against? Move to clause...
Through the chair, just what was that vote?
Clause 9.
What was the total of that vote?
5-4.
5-4.
But remember, this is a process that we're saying that this is where we have voted on this for the consideration.
Yep. I think he asked what was the result.
All right, sorry, 5-4.
Yeah.
Move to clause 10, register of interests. I advise members the bill sponsor is proposing two amendments to clause 10 to align it with the relevant code of conduct provisions. The bill sponsor is proposing one further amendment to clause 10 to include a definition of a family members. For the amendment, put the question, is the committee content with the amendments proposed by the bill sponsor to clause 10? Content? On the substantive on clause 10, put the question, is the committee content with clause 10 subject to the amendments proposed by the bill sponsor? All those in favour, raise their hands. Okay. All those against? Moving on to clause 11, offence of unauthorised disclosure. Advise members of the bill sponsor is proposing one amendment to clause 11 to simplify the language. To protect FOI obligations and internal government communications, to introduce reasonable behaviour and public interest defence, and to introduce a maximum sentence of 2 years rather than 5 years and proposed in the bill as drafted. Is the committee content with the amendment proposed by the bill sponsor to clause 11? All those in favour, raise their hands. Okay. Against? We move on to clause 11. But the question is, the committee content with clause 11 subject to the amendment proposed by the bill sponsor? Those in favour, raise their hands.
Sorry.
I noticed that, Matthew.
Yeah, I got that.
Those against? Move on to clause 12, biennial report.
Could I just intervene? If there was more members against the clause as amended, do you want to take a clause as drafted on that particular one? The committee has a differing view on the clause as drafted. There were five weren't content with the amendment, so...
We could ask the question if was the committee content with clause 11 as drafted? I'll put that to the committee. Would the committee be content with clause 11 as drafted? Two. Would the committee, those against clause 11 as drafted? Okay.
Abstentions.
Any abstentions? One. Okay. Does that clarify that point?
Yes, it was just, I noticed actually in clause 9 and clause 11, there were two where the no's for amendments were greater than the...
Yeah.
I didn't get your vote, Chair, sorry, on that.
No, that was against that one.
And sorry, also, Chair, in relation to clause 9, I think it was a similar situation, so
yes.
You may want to go back and visit it as drafted.
Committee, would we ask the question again on clause 9?
Is the committee content with clause 9 as drafted? Against?
Abstentions, Chair.
Abstentions. One. I can move on to clause 12, the biennial report. Advise members, the bill sponsor is proposing one technical amendment to clause 12. Put the question, is the committee content with the amendment proposed, the bill sponsor, to clause 12? Agreed. Clause 12. Put the question, is the committee content with clause 12, subject to the amendment proposed by the bill sponsor? Those in favour, raise their hands. Those against?
Sure. Have you noted 11?
11A.
Yeah.
11A?
Yeah.
It'll be at the end.
It'll be at the end, yeah. Okay, move on to clause 13, commencement. Is the committee content with clause 13 as drafted? Those in favour, raise their hands. Those against? Clause 14, interpretation. Advise members, the sponsor is proposing an amendment to clause 14 to provide a definition of family member. The bill sponsor is proposing a further amendment to clause 14 to provide a definition of department. The amendment, is the committee content with the amendments proposed to the bill sponsor to clause 14?
Yes.
Content. Clause 14 then. Put the question, is the committee content with clause 14 subject to the amendments proposed by the bill sponsor? All those in favour, raise their hands. Those against? Clause 15, short title, the Functioning of Government Miscellaneous Provision Acts Northern Ireland 2020. Is the committee content with clause 15 as drafted? Those in favour, raise their hands. Those against?
Can you vote against the title? It seems daft. It's either a title or it isn't.
Thank you for your remarks. Duly noted, Mr. Wells. Honourable member from South Down. Right. Next item, transitional provisions, termination payments. The schedule. Is the committee content for the schedule as drafted? Those in favour, raise their hands. Against? Thank you. The long title of the bill. Amend section 7 and 8 of the Civil Service Special Advisors Act Northern Ireland 2013 and Article 3 of the Civil Service Commissioners Northern Ireland Order 1999 in relation to special advisors in the Northern Ireland Civil Service. Repeal Civil Service Commissioners Amendment Order Northern Ireland 2016. Amend section 17 of the Assembly Members Independent Financial Review and Standards Act Northern Ireland 2011 and to make a additional provision for the functioning of government in Northern Ireland and connected purposes. All those in favour agreeing the long title of the bill, raise their hands.
Surely not.
Those against. Right, there you go. Okay.
11A.
Sorry, Chair, it should have been at the end there, but it seems to have been omitted from the Chair's brief.
Can we?
So, if members are content to note.
Right, I'll just ask that question. Are members content to note amendment 11A? Clause 11A?
Clause 11A.
Are members content to note clause 11A? Those in favour, raise their hand.
Yeah.
Those against? There we go. Right, Claire, before I bring this item on the agenda to the end, have we done what we're supposed to have done?
Yes.
Thank you very much indeed. And Claire, thank you very much indeed for your forbearance and support. And may I thank the committee for speeding this passage through. Thank you very much indeed. If we move on to number item 7 of business as chairperson is business, the no chairperson is business. If I move on to item number 8, correspondence. Response from the Department of Economy regarding personal protective equipment, page 491. Members, do we have any comment?
Where are we on?
Are we content to note?
Noted.
Response from the Department of Finance regarding OECD review, monitoring and ongoing review and mission statement to Public Sector Reform Division, page 493. Members, do we have any comment? Where's Matthew gone? What was his?
His baby.
Going to the toilet. To walk out. To walk out.
I'll come back to that. If you don't, if with your forbearance, I'll come back to that piece of correspondence. Departmental response to committee regarding the coalition of data and relating to homeworking on page 504. Do we have any comments? Members, are we content to note? Matthew, apologies, you went out when your item of correspondence came up, so I've redirected it to come back to it with the, right. The committee's forbearance. A response from the Department of Finance regarding OECD review, page 493. Do you have any particular comments? Ask members, are therefore, if we content to schedule an oral evidence from OECD following the Halloween recess. Are we content?
From the OECD itself? I suppose there's a slight concern that the person who did the study might not still be there, but right. If they're there, it'd be great to hear from them.
If I ask you to go to the table page, table papers at page 8. Okay. This is some correspondence that's come in from the Minister. I just want you to have a note of that. If you just give me a bit of seconds when I bring it back up. The committee considered the SL1 the correspondence with the Minister regarding the statutory rule on the financial assistance coronavirus regulations Northern Ireland 2020 is at page 8. The committee considered the SL1 at last week's meeting and was content with the policy proposals. The rule is subject to negative resolution procedure. Since last week's meeting, the Executive has agreed to add an additional higher tier and consequential upward revision of costs. No further detail is included in the correspondence. I just wanted to seek your agreement to ask the Department to provide full details to the committee through the clerk in advance of the statutory rule coming into the operation on Friday of the changes of the policy proposals, the overview of the tiers, including the criteria for eligibility under each criteria, the explanation of the rationale for the amendments, and details of how the revisions will impact on the 3.5 million that had previously been allocated. And it's our presumption it's an increase in allocation, but we just don't know what the delta is at the moment. Okay. If you're content, committee, to wait a response and consider the SR at next week's committee meeting. Are we content?
Content.
Okay, thank you. Response from the Minister regarding details of EU funding that has not yet been received. That's tabled at page 9. Do we have any comments? I'd like to suggest the members would forward on to the EU Affairs Manager, RAISE and Committee for Agriculture, Economy and TEO for information if we are content. Are we content? I would like us to note the remaining items of correspondence and to note the information request of the Department and routine papers circulated on the 9th of October 2020. Are we content?
Okay.
Move on to item number 9 in the agenda, the Forward Work Programme. Inform members an updated draft work forward work programme September-December 2020 is page 543. Any comments? Jim?
Could I just add, I don't want to pressurise the clerk, but now that we've finished the clause by clause stage of the bill, at some point we'll be considering the report. Have we an idea where that would be?
Chair, I'm well through the drafting of the report, and I would be hoping to bring it to the committee for the meeting on the 4th of November.
Very good. And could I just put on record appreciation to the clerk? I thought his clause-by-clause exposition today was very helpful, and the clerk and his staff who put in all the work. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Chair. I'll pass that on.
Sorry, through the Chair. I'm sorry, I didn't hear what you said there.
Oh, sorry. I was thanking the clerk for all the work that he put in for the clause-by-clause decisions, because I thought it was very fulsome and very well put together.
Agreed.
Great.
Can we vote on that?
steady. Remind members that the Minister has confirmed his availability to provide oral evidence to the committee at next week's meeting on the impact of the cancellation of the UK budget, tabled at page 13. I think for that very valuable session we had earlier on about the estimates, there are a few questions that I think we agreed from there that we'd like to forward to the Minister as well to ask some questions about. Particularly, I think, was the issues about implications of the finance bill or the non-finance bill, as it looks as if it is being. The second question was particularly to look at the amount of money that we are expecting and were asked for what's going to happen from the 1st of January and the significant implications of that and the opportunities to do that. And I think the other issue we wanted to talk about is ask the Minister to outline what his proposals are about transferring, looking at the opportunities to have flexibility to transfer capital to resource and to do that, and also to look at what he's asking for and carry forward. Have I missed anything?
The internal market bill?
Oh, yes, the internal, yeah.
Can I also add the concern that this committee has shared many times around the relationship between the committee and the department, the furnishing of information when we request it the first time, and then also the email with regards to the Republic of Ireland official asking them to remove or reverse the press statement on the PPE order and how that was dealt with.
Also inform members that Land and Property Services is scheduled to provide written evidence and oral evidence on fraud and other matters on the 11th and 18th of November, respectively. Are we content to receive evidence from Land and Property Services on these dates? Members are content with the forward work programme? Members, do we have any other items of business? Bearing in mind, we're about to go into a closed session very shortly. Date and time of next place meeting, 21st of October at 1400 here. And we shall now move into a closed session regarding the RHI disciplinary process.
This is the Northern Ireland Assembly Senate Chamber programme sound. This is the Northern Ireland Assembly Senate Chamber programme sound.